السلام عليكم ورحمة الله وبركاته. Today إن شاء الله we are expecting a very nice talk to complete the radial course from Professor Dr. Mansoor Salam, and he will talk about radial artery complication during diagnostic and coronary intervention via radial artery axis. I'm sure you will enjoy this talk because it's real cases. And I will leave the floor now to Dr. Mansoor to start his presentation. But I want to tell everybody, for me and Dr. Mansoor Mustafa, we will share the meeting. And please, if you want to talk, please raise your hand and I will go to your name and I will allow to you speak. But please, anybody who want to talk during the presentation, just raise your hand. I will see your hand. I will go to your name and I will click. So you are allowed to talk and to unmute yourself. So it will be interactive session, inshallah. Tafadhal Dr. Mansoor.
A'udhu billahi minash shaitanir rajim. Bismillahir rahmanir rahim. Qul inna salati wa nusuki wa mahyaya wa mamati lillahi rabbil alamin. My colleagues, it gives me pleasure and joy to present the 16th session of the Al-Azhar Radial course. I'm extremely happy today to present a hot topic in the transradial approach complications in front of my dear seniors, Dr. Mansoor Mustafa and Dr. Abdul Masood. Also, I would like to tell you that this transradial complications session, I would like to be an active session. I will present. If you would like to interactive or to interact, please, I think the panelists will allow you to ask, to repeat, to clarify everything. I would like this session to be one of the best sessions that we did in the course, inshallah. First of all, I would like to ask, why radial? I think this question should be asked by all interventional cardiologists. Why radial? I will answer this question on your behalf. Why radial? Why radial? Because of the proven safety over as opposed to the transfemoral approach. This proven safety profile came mainly because of the less local vascular complications. Why radial? Because of the better patient satisfaction that driven mainly by less complications, because of the better quality of life, because of the early ambulation. And this early ambulation allowed for early discharge from the hospital with cost effectiveness. This proven safety was augmented mainly in patients with acute coronary syndrome, segment elevation, myocardial infarction, and those patients who presented with high bleeding risk. And also, there is a notion about that the radial approach is associated with less acute kidney injury in patients presented with acute coronary syndrome. Mainly, or the proposal is due to less cholesterol embolization when you do coronary angiography from the femoral approach. We don't traverse the renal arteries, so there is no cholesterol embolization. So this is the explanation why those patients with radial approach will get less acute kidney injury. However, presence of any complication, could you please mute yourself, Dr. Maqsood, Dr. Mansoor? Okay, Timberlin. Okay, presence of any complication in the transradial approach definitely will offset this advantage of transradial approach as opposed to the transfemoral approach. From my own clinical experience, I can classify the transradial complications into minor and major complications. Please, you can agree, disagree, modify. You can ask about this because this is my own classification. It is not published in the literature. So minor complications like what? Like spaz, grade 1 or 2 spaz, but definitely grade 3 or 4. I think they are considered to be major. We'll clarify all these issues. And hematoma, grade 1, 2, and sometimes 3, considered to be a minor, but definitely grade 4 or 5, or any intrathoracic hematoma that represent a major threat to the life, the patient's life, should be classified as a major. Perforation, any perforation from the radial to the ascending aorta should be classified as a major. Any radial artery occlusion, despite most of this occlusion considered to be asymptomatic, but I think we should consider it as a major or Achilles heel of the transradial approach. Dissections, if happened from the radial to brachial artery, I would classify as a minor and I will explain. But any intrathoracic dissection, I think, should be classified as a major. Catheter kink that can be easily solved, I think, as opposed to catheter knot, no, I think should be considered as a major problem. Post angiography pain that lasts for just a few days and it disappears, it's a minor, but agonizing pain, I think, is a major issue. Vasovagal with vasodepressor that improves immediately by atropine or fluid, I think, is a minor issue. But I experienced one of my patients experienced complete heart block from the visual attack requiring pacemaker, so I think it's a major issue. There are anecdotal or very rare cases like arteriovenous fistula, pseudoaneurysm, or granuloma should be considered as a minor because of the incidence is very low. But stent dislodgement that we will discuss right now, I think we can classify as a major issue. I will start by the first complication, which is the radial artery spasm. Radial artery spasm, should we worry? Prevention, recognition, and the management, and its relation to coronary artery spasm. We had this presentation exactly 2 weeks ago in a separate session. It was a very long, detailed session. In this session, we discussed the definition, epidemiology, pathophysiology, predictors of radial artery stenosis diagnosis, how to prevent and the sequelae. And already I posted the link of this presentation in Lazar Radial Course Facebook page. So you can go back, please. But I would like to stress upon the radial artery spasm scale. Grade one spasm is a minimal spasm or minimal pain or discomfort that the patient can experience. But usually you can finish your procedure without any sequelae. Grade two, it's a significant spasm. However, with this significant spasm, you can continue your procedure without any crossover. Grade three is a severe local pain or discomfort. No, I think you mute yourself, Dr. Masoud. Grade three is a severe local pain and discomfort during necessitating crossover to another route. So I think it's a major issue as well. Grade four, which is severe local spasm and discomfort, which is associated with catheter trapping. Catheter is entrapped. We cannot take the catheter out like this patient that we experienced. The catheter entrapped, and I am doing my best to take the catheter back. I'm
doing my best right now, okay. To withdraw the catheter.
Okay. I think I think this patient will never forget this bad experience because of the intense radial artery spasm. Anyhow, radial artery spasm is reported to happen in approximately 20% of the patients. And in those patients who present with high radial takeoff, it happens in approximately 50% of those patients, very high incidence. Usually this radial artery spasm, intense radial artery spasm, or this intense radial artery spasm, or this one, usually is associated with higher incidence of crossover rate, higher incidence of entrapment, bad experience. How can we avoid and how can we treat? Please, okay, I posted already in the Facebook Al-Azhar Radial Course page. You can go and you can, I think, you can enjoy, you can comment, and we will recommend about that. So this is the first and the commonest complications that happen at the transradial axis. Second complication that I would like to discuss with you today is the radial artery perforation. Radial artery perforation, please take it as a tip. For any interventional cardiologist, should never push against resistance. You have to have very low threshold to visualize the forearm and arm anatomy via side port of the radial sheath. Very low threshold once you encounter any resistance to avoid such complications. And radial artery perforation. Just a sealing of the perforation or reconstruction. What is the difference? What is the difference? Just to highlight that sealing, meaning that when you have perforation, so From external compression, you can compress the radial artery. By this mean, bleeding will stop. But at the meantime, the radial artery will occlude because you are obstructing the vessel from outside. But by this way of reconstructing vessel, what will happen? You will maintain radial artery patency, and at the meantime, you will do hemostasis. What are the difference? Please, just to come and we can discuss this cases. This is Mr. Harry. This is Mr. Harry, Dr. Mansour, mute yourself, please. Mr. Harry is 69 Canadian guy, hypertensive, not diabetic, presented with acute coronary syndrome, non-ischemic elevation, myocardial infarction, and we went through the right radial approach. Okay, we went, and we found this very tight obtuse marginal or subtotal obtuse marginal lesion with a very tight mid-segment LAD bridge. Right coronary artery was no significance, okay? So while we are preparing for Judkin lift, we found a resistance and we injected from the side port of the radial sheath and we found this ugly perforation. So what we did, the precise crossing of this perforation by the BTCA wire, we crossed and we placed the guiding catheter and we did BCI, stented the radial, the obtuse marginal branch. And at the end of the procedure, while we finishing, we did injection and we found the radial artery perforation has completely sealed. So what happened and how did we treat Mr. Harry? Radial artery perforation, remember, happened after diagnostic coronary angiography. Anyone of you, please don't make a decision and cross over to another route or whatever. No, you have to insist to go from the similar same route, radial artery, the perforated, and cross it meticulously. Cross the radial artery perforation with the BCA wire and complete your BCI or diagnostic procedure if you didn't do. And the guide catheter or the diagnostic catheter will act as a hemostatic device sealing the perforation. This happens in the vast majority of the patients. So be sure, cross, don't cross over to the right radial or the perforated segment. So what are the pearls from this case that we did right now? I didn't neutralize the heparin because just we stented the patient. Final forearm angiography is a must just to be sure about the status of your radial artery. Doublex scan helps a lot and gives you a lot of information as we will display it right now. Another patient that I would like to share with you with this radial artery perforation. This is a short, morbidly obese patient, not hypertensive, not diabetic, referred from a hospital with agonizing chest pain. With ECG, ECG showed what? Showed this pattern. Diffuse deep segment elevation, depression, T-wave inversion, sorry, in all pericardial leads, as well as the inferior leads as well. So I think there's a differential diagnosis of three situations. First one is acute ischemia. Second is cerebral hemorrhage, subarachnoid hemorrhage, I mean, or hookum. So what we did, just we would like, we went through the right radial and we found the resistance to advance the wire. So we had very low threshold to visualize what happened. And we found this localized perforation exactly at the end of the radial sheath. What we do? Shall we bring a sphygmomanometer cuff and press this just to contain this hemorrhage? No, we crossed by the BTCA wire, soft wire, and we performed our diagnostic coronary angiography, and it was almost normal. There is no abnormality in the coronary arteries, as we did expect. So we did left ventriculography through the big tail in both RLO and RU views. That proved a spade-like appearance, a spade-like, which is a characteristic for hookum. Okay, after removal of the big tail, we did expect that the this catheter will act as a hemostatic device and the perforation will seal, exactly as we did with Mr. Harry. But we haven't, unfortunately, the bleeding persisted. So what we did in this case, we did balloon tamponading. There is a balloon, 3-0 balloon, 20 millimeter, inflated at 6 atmospheric pressure and continued for approximately 20 minutes. And after that, what happened? Nice. We maintained the flow. No more bleeding. And the artery kept open. If we close this from external compression by sphygmomanometer cuff, we do expect that yes, bleeding may stop or will stop, but the definitely the artery will collapse, the artery will occlude as well, the radial artery. So how do we did Mrs. Fatma? Remember, radial artery perforation happened before diagnostic coronary angiography. Before we start, we insisted to cross by the BCA wire, and we completed our procedure. And balloon tamponading, I think, may help if the your catheter failed to seal the perforation. The third case is a 64 hypertensive diabetic patient, short stature as well. This patient presented with a chest pain, and non-invasive investigations proved evidence of ischemic heart disease. So what happened? We found this diet to tandem lesion in the proximal mid-LED and distal LED with no significant lesion in the RCA. So I think it was a straightforward case to do PCI, and we did by drug-eluting stent with nice result. While we are going out, the patient experienced massive right forearm swelling, and immediately we injected contrast, and we found this huge or severe radial artery perforation. We finished the procedure as well. Shall we bring the sphygmomanometer cuff and collapse the artery? No. We recrossed by the same BTCA wire, and we placed the diagnostic catheter, RCA, right catheter, JR catheter, proximal to the perforation for 20 minutes, but unfortunately failed to seal the perforation. We repeated this same exercise for 2 times. So total time was approximately 1 hour. We placed the catheter proximal to the perforation. But unfortunately, this is the picture after the placing the catheter for 1 hour. Perforation persisted. So what is the second weapon in our hands right now is to do balloon tamponading. This is a balloon, same balloon, but it's 15 balloon, okay? Inflated for also 3 times, but unfortunately, the perforation persisted, despite it is less. But this, I think this enough if we leave like that. It is enough to cause compartment syndrome if left like that. So what we can do? Shall we ask for surgeons but they were not visible, and I think it will be extremely difficult situation after just we deployed the stent, drug-eluting stent. If we discontinue the dual antiplatelet therapy, stented thrombosis and may endanger the patient's life, I think it is an issue. So what we can do and for this situation, we thought to deploy covered stent, completely seal the perforation. The patient hand saved, alhamdulillah. Okay, despite she developed grade 4 hematoma, we'll classify right now. Okay, but fortunately, I think we did duplex scan that proved evidence of maintained patency of the radial artery with no major hematoma endangering the patient's hand. So this is the 1 day after the perforation, and this exactly 4 weeks follow-up. The patient completely sealed, completely recovered, completely cured during that time. The patient was fully ambulant. We reported this case as a first case in man, radial artery perforation or radial to be treated with the covered stent. It was the first to be reported in literature. And we granted the best challenging case in Washington, TCT. And after cumulative experience with many patients, we published our experience how to treat radial artery perforation. And I do advise all of you, all interventional cardiologists treating or dealing with radial artery, to read this paper, how to treat. So after 5 years, the same patient came with a chest pain. So I did coronary angiography via right radial artery that proved evidence of maintained patency of the previously deployed covered stent. The last case in the radial artery perforation I would like to share with you, Egyptian lady, approximately 150 kilograms. Huge patient, hypertensive, presented with high-risk acute coronary syndrome, non-stigmatic elevation myocardial infarction. I remember this patient very well. He received intense medical therapy. However, persistent chest pain that didn't respond to the medical therapy. Radial artery, we tried radial approach. There is non-significant lesion in the mid-LED. But look here, the RCA takes retrograde collaterals from the LED. And look here, there is high grade proximal RCA lesion. I think it is clear that this is a culprit lesion for us. So what we do? I think a straightforward case to do BCI. Could you please I think anyone, please, could you please mute yourself, Dr. Panelist, please. So I think this is a culprit leader right now. Straightforward, we have to prepare the GR guide catheter to tackle this lesion. But unfortunately, we experienced problem to advance the wire. And the injection through the right forearm proved that. What are the problems here? The first problem is the radial artery stenosis, diffuse, very long radial artery stenosis with high takeoff radial artery. And at the meantime, there is radial artery perforation. Could you please just concentrate in this segment? This is a breast shadow, by the way. There is a radial artery perforation. It will be clear after that. Don't worry. Okay. And we have another problem, which is right coronary artery critical lesion. And remember, the patient is having ongoing chest pain with high-grade proximal RC lesion. So how to solve this problem right now? Shall I cross over to another root, right ulnar, for example, or left radial, or left ulnar, or femoral? Or shall I use the same root? I think the wise decision should entail both. I think we have to gain both advantages by a same stone, which is we have to go through the same route to advance the guide catheter. This may act as a hemostatic device to close the perforation or to seal the perforation. And in the meantime, you can perform your BCI. So in this situation, we crossed by the balloon-assisted tracking. We reached the coronaries. This is a tight lesion. And we fixed the lesion by one large long drag eluting stent. We didn't expect that after the BCI, the perforation will heal, but will seal. But unfortunately, this is a perforation that happened for this patient. This is a huge perforation because of this side branch injury, or this is by wrong entry of the wire. So what happened? Failed this catheter to seal the perforation. So second step, as I mentioned right now, this is a balloon tamponading, or three times balloon tamponading failed. So what to do? Okay, balloon tamponading failed. So what to do? We have a problem right now. Catheter failed to seal. Balloon tamponading failed to seal. But unfortunately, and unfortunately, covered stent, there is no appropriate size is not available. What to do? Shall we ask the help of cardiosurgeons? Okay, and remember, just we deployed one drug eluting stent. So I think the main issue here that I thought in is to manufacture a handmade covered stent on a spot. How can we handmade covered stent? Okay, just look for this video, please. Okay, here I dissected the balloon from the catheter and I cut it. I used a short segment from the balloon. I'm cutting. This is a 2.5 balloon, by the way, semi-compliant. So I used the biometric stent, 2.25, 14. Okay. And I cut very small segment, approximately 4 millimeter balloon. By this new method, the stent, proximal and distal drug eluting stent, and in the middle is the handmade or this balloon to seal the perforation. You will find a problem. Usually, you will find a problem to load the balloon inside the catheter, inside the stent. So what I did, I loaded the balloon, the cut balloon, the cut segment, and the another wire, and through this wire, I loaded inside the stent, and I am loading right now. I am loading. Okay, just look for this segment. Okay, so I think this is an important issue.
والفكره بقى في اللينس بتاع
البالون كفر بص كده احنا تقريبا نص الستنت بره. So half of the stent, okay, approximately 14 millimeter stent. approximately half of it, approximately 5 millimeter in the proximal, 5 millimeter in the distal, and this is the balloon. I think that to seal the perforation. So this is a balloon mounted with this stent mounted as a balloon. I crossed the perforation, which is here right now, to avoid dislodgement of this balloon. So I came back, okay, exactly, precisely at the site of perforation. This is the loaded balloon. This segment is drug-eluting stent, and this segment is drug-eluting stent as well. And I inflated the balloon at high pressure, inflated. Fortunately, there is no more leak. I left the sheath inside the radial sheath, I mean, okay, inside the patient for approximately 5 hours until I finished the list. This is the picture after 5 hours, completely sealed the perforation and the hematoma resolved, alhamdulillah. Okay, so handmade covered stent is the first case report to seal the radial artery perforation. By the meantime, we have few case reports to seal type 3 coronary artery perforation, but this is the first case to be treated for radial artery perforation. So to summarize how to manage radial artery perforation, selected for arm angiography, I think is a must when you have a suspicion of radial artery perforation. You have to advance and maintain BCA wire proximal to the perforation, guide catheter or guide or diagnostic catheter to complete the procedure. In vast majority of situations, this will act as a hemostatic device and your perforation will seal. Repeat the angiogram to prove. If failed, this placing the catheter proximal to the perforation, so balloon tamponading is another weapon in your hand. And if failed, so cover the stent, I think you will solve the problem of your patient. Don't forget the ultrasound. It's your friend. Ultrasound and duplex scan to assess the patency of the radial artery, presence or absence of any other extravasation. I think it is a must to do. The third perforation that I would like to discuss with you is the hematoma. But hematoma discussed very nicely by a magnificent presentation by Dr. Samir Banshuli in the third session. I will post the link on the Al-Azhar Radial Course Facebook page, inshallah. But just I would like to stress upon the right arm hematoma, which is considered to be the commonest bleeding complication of transradial intervention. Hematoma classification is very, very important for every interventionalist to know. This proposed by Dr. Burton classified hematoma into 5 categories. Grade 1, which is confined to the radial artery puncture, which extends for approximately 5 centimeters from the puncture site. Grade 2 extends for approximately 10 centimeters. Grade 3, this extends below the elbow. And the grade 4, if extends above the elbow, to the grade 4. What is the grade 5? Grade 5 is a compartment syndrome. I will repeat. Okay, just look for this patient right now who present with ulnar hematoma. This is my patient, ulnar hematoma. This is ulnar hematoma here presented, the patient presented later. Okay, after this hematoma, after we sealed the perforation, I mean, okay, into grade 4 hematoma. So these are the considered to be class 1 or grade 1 hematoma, approximately 5 centimeters from the puncture site. This is the only segment that was the perforation or this hematoma, so approximately 10 centimeters, so grade 2. This is the grade 3 below the elbow, and these are the grade 4 above the elbow hematomas that we have to remember. These grade 4 hematomas, or grade 1 and grade 2, usually confined to the puncture site. Usually they are superficial, so don't worry about these hematomas, inshallah, nothing will happen. Grade 3 and grade 4, usually there is intramuscular bleed, so I think the fear of the compartment syndrome, I think, should be considered for all of these patients, grade 3 and grade 4. This is, I think, a devastating complication of the transradial approach that we shouldn't see. And fortunately, the compartment syndrome reported very, very, very rarely in the literature. This is due to sharp increase of the pressure inside the intercompartmental. The normal pressure of the compartments is from 0 to 10 millimeter mercury. When it is raised to 30 millimeter mercury, usually it will result in pressure on the vital organs, on the arteries, veins, lymphatics, the nerves and the muscles, and finally will be damaged if you didn't solve this problem. Almost always remember 5 P's, okay, for your patient: pain, pallor, paresthesia, paralysis, pulses. Pain due to compression of the vital organs. Pallor is due to the compression of the vasculature, ulnar and radial arteries. Paresthesia due to compression of the nerve, and paralysis due to compression of the muscles. And finally, you will lose the pulse and you may lose the patient completely because of the acute kidney injury and this if you didn't save your patient. So many tips and tricks as you have to consider while you are driving your patient from transradial approach. Check the TR band frequently, please, for any bleeding. Early management, early recognition is very, very important. Any complaint by the patient, any pain, please consider it as a serious issue. Check for any swelling of the arm. It is very, very important. Any active bleeding like perforation should be managed, as I mentioned just right now. In general, how to manage? In the first 48 hours, rice. Don't give your patient rice, no, but you can give him rest. Arm rest, cold vomits for the first 48 hours, compression and hand elevation to facilitate venous drainage. It can be applied every 15 minutes. This is in the first 48 hours. In second, after 48 hours, hot vomits play an important role for this, just to improve the vasculature, circulation, and to help for venous drainage. Mild hematoma usually will heal in a matter of 3 days, 4 days, maximum week, and the large hematomas usually it takes 3-4 weeks to heal. These are your friends, bandage as well as the hemostatic or the sphygmomanometer cuff, usually used frequently for those patients. For grade 3 and 4 hematomas, neutralization heparin, if you finished your BCI or diagnostic, I think it is a wise, and use a rice method as well. This is our patient that healed after 4 weeks after application of all these advices. Grade 5 compartment syndrome, I think we have to discontinue heparin and to neutralize rice method. Any radial perforation should be treated very, very fast. And even sometimes we can use dehydration by mannitol or furosemide to reduce the compartment edema. And you have to ask in such a situation surgical fasciotomy. Otherwise, you may lose the hand of your patient or you may lose the patient completely. These are not my patients, okay? I took it or found in the literature with very, very, very aseptic or the blisters, okay, that can be evacuated and resulted in the cure of these patients. I didn't see these complications. Compartment syndrome, I didn't see any compartment syndrome in any of my patients, approximately 6,000-7,000 patients I didn't see, and I have no wish to see, and I have no one of you to see this complication. Also, medicinal hematoma reported due to injury of the innominate artery, injury of the subclavian artery. So I think we have to be very, very cautious while you are driving your catheter through these vital structures. Fourth complications that we may face, okay, this is the dissection. Dissection may happen from the radial artery until the coronaries. Just look for this dissection. It is here, okay. The value of the radial artery, if you dissected here, usually the dissection comes with the flow. The flow comes from the subclavian artery to the brachial artery to the radial artery. So usually these dissections will heal because it is in the pathway of the flow. So usually there is no major issue, and usually this dissection will heal spontaneously, inshallah. Even those patients, this is one of my patients who experienced, I did dissection of the subclavian artery at the level of the lima artery. Fortunately, the lima is here right now, alhamdulillah, is after lima, so there was no problem. Can you imagine if this dissection happens at the lima? I think myocardial infarction will happen. Or at the level of the vertebral artery. So I think also the patient will get CVA. Sometimes, if you dissected the innominate artery, right side hemiplegia, I think, or left side hemiplegia will happen because of the destruction of the right cerebral hemisphere. Or if you can imagine, if you injure this artery, what is this bovine artery? This is a bovine arch in which there is a common artery that supplies common artery that gives blood supply to both left common carotid and the innominate artery. If you injured this artery, what do you expect? Massive cerebral hemorrhage, and I think your patient will not complete, will continue. I am mentioning all these complications, but I am reminding all my colleagues about such complications and more, because many complications will happen in the radial root as well, in the femoral root as well. And can you imagine if you are driving your patient or from doing catheterization from the femoral approach and your wire hated this huge aneurysm, what will happen for those patients? This patient definitely will die immediately without a known cause. So the fifth complications I would like to discuss with you is the stent lost and found. This patient, 49 year old, presented with astigmatic elevation myocardial infarction. There is a tight LED lesion, proximal mid LED lesion, and tight OM lesion, as you see. I think straightforward, working from the right radial artery, BCI to LED. And I did prefer for this tight lesion to be done immediately. Okay, so I think, okay, direct stenting also for OM. But what happened? I am centralizing my stent right now, placing my stent, and we are inflating the stent. With each inflation, I found that the distal artery is visualized. What happened? I think this is a sure sign that the balloon is damaged. Balloon is perforated. So what to do? What to do? I think we have to take the stent completely out. So I took the stent completely out, and I am breathing just to show you this case. And I am full range of motion of mine. We stopped here. I am dry, I'm pulling the catheter with the stent. Okay, pulling. So I stopped because my motion has stopped in this segment. And all of a sudden, but just take care where I stopped. I stopped, fortunately, at the brachial artery, exactly at the brachial artery. So stent is here right now. It is in a safe place. But unfortunately, without any introduction, my nurse has withdrawn the catheter out, the stent catheter. I don't know. Anyhow, we lost the stent. But where is the stent? I don't know. We didn't find the stent. During that time, the patient experienced agonizing pain. So what to do? The stent right now, I think, will come down by any means, but the patient is having chest pain. So immediately, I went to took another stent, deployed and fixed the problem. And now we are in safe situation, a little bit safe situation, inshallah. We are looking for the stent. Where is the lost stent? Lost stent, we found the stent here in the superficial palmar branch of the ulnar artery. This is the radius, this is the ulna. So this is the ulnar artery and the stent is here. Just look, this is the stent. This is the stent, okay, stent in the ulna right now. So what to do? Anyhow, we ask the help of vascular surgeon because I cannot take this stent, I think. What to do? I'm asking the panelists right now, Dr. Mansour, Dr. Maksud, what do you think? I can see Dr. Ahmed Nada as well. Okay, what to do for this patient? Surgical, to take the stent out. Just remember, we deployed two stents right now. Do you have any way to take this percutaneously, or shall we do conservative management for this patient? I am asking you, please.
Yeah, very difficult situation. The sheath in the femoral and the stent in the ulnar. So the hand, it will be compromised if you will not remove the stent in the ulnar artery. So I think the best way here, you can do percutaneous puncture to the ulnar artery, and you can go by the wire. If you are lucky, it will be inside the stent, and you can snare it because it's partially deployed. So I think the diameter, it will be less than 2 millimeter diameter, which is equal the size of the ulnar artery. I think this is the first trial, the first step to try to take it percutaneous after puncturing the ulnar artery. If it's failed the procedure, and I think it will be successful, you can ask the surgeon to remove it as by surgical approach. But I think the percutaneous approach, it will be appropriate and it will be successful.
Okay. Dr. Mansour? Unmute yourself. Unmute yourself first, please.
I think Dr. Mansour, this is like situation as regards the radial artery, minor surgical procedure through the vascular surgeon, it's better, and they can controlling the bleeding local, which is better, I think. Okay. The successful rate is very high and less complication, and they can overcome any complication through the small and the minor surgery, which okay. is better.
I do agree a little bit with you. Dr. Ahmed Nada, if you hear us. Okay, so.
Yeah, assalamu alaikum.
Alaikum salam.
First of all, my greetings to Dr. Abdul Masood and Dr. Mansour Mustafa. For you, Dr. Mansour, for sure. First issue, what was the situation? I mean, did the patient complain at that time?
At all.
And the second, the second issue, okay. Was the stent actually a little bit inflated or still compressed?
Like you, I think, I don't know, but I think not inflated because the balloon was damaged. Balloon was ruptured. So I yes. think most likely not inflated.
In such situation, actually, maybe I go for conservative management at that time and I follow the patient. And if there is any advancement or progressiveness towards whatever difficult difficult to feel the pulsation or any signs over the skin or any complaint from the patient, I may refer the patient for surgery.
Extremely happy for this, I think, discussion. Dr. Maksoud preferred percutaneous approach. Dr. Mansour preferred surgical. Dr. Ahmed first conservative and then surgical approach. But just to make it short, what I did X-ray, routine X-ray on the hand after just a few, 1 hour exactly, and we found this stent became in the superficial palmar arch, so deeply situated. So I think there is no rule for percutaneous decision here. And I think also the surgical decision, it will be extremely difficult. But anyhow, we referred this patient, cross-consulted the vascular surgeon. They did prefer to conservative treatment. And the patient was following with me right now for more than one year. And the patient is doing fine without any problem. I can feel the radial and can feel the ulnar artery. Nothing happened at all. And based on the experience of our vascular surgeon, he said that, don't worry. Nothing will happen. No stent thrombosis, and the patient is doing fine. Interesting case, I think. Catheter kink and catheter not. Because of the extreme tortuosity that may happen, especially in elderly patients, octogenarians, especially octogenarians, hypertensive patients, short stature patients, catheter may kink or may completely not. How to prevent the kink and how to unknot the knot? I think it was a fantastic presentation given by my dear colleague, Dr. Hatim Lawati. I think I will post the link for this presentation in the Al-Azhar Radial Course Facebook page. I think you can refer back just to make it short, or just to save time. The seventh problem that we can discuss, I would like to discuss with you, is the radial artery occlusion. Radial artery occlusion. Just look for this patient. Okay, radial artery is occluded from its origin. One of you can argue me, what is the problem for artery to be occluded? And our colleagues, the surgeons, usually they harvest it for the radial artery conduit. So what is the problem? The hand is rich of vascular network. So no hand ischemia, I do agree. No problem at all. So just let us discuss some facts about the radial artery. First fact, the radial artery occlusion remains the Achilles heel for the transradial approach. Despite our efforts to reduce the radial artery occlusion, it happens against our will. So this is the Achilles heel of the transradial approach. Thus, the majority of situations, radial artery occlusion is asymptomatic. It happens many and many, okay, without any symptoms because of extensive collateral circulation. Even more, spontaneous recanalization happens by 30 days due to autolysis. That happens by 30 days, 1 month, usually 50%, it will be restored. The fourth fact that, please, who would like to keep the radial artery open to reuse it as for further coronary angiograms, arteriovenous fistulas, or graft for CABG. But I would like to tell you that some patients may come severe agonizing chest hand pain because of the ischemia itself. And in some situations, palpable pulse is not reliable to diagnose. This is a fact about it. Because of the retrograde collateral that comes from the ulnar artery, you may feel the radial artery distally. It is not the radial artery. It is the concomitant branch that gives the rise retrograde collateral. But the standard diagnostic tool to diagnose radial artery occlusion is the ultrasound. The incidence of radial artery occlusion differs from study to study based on many parameters. One of the most of these is the sheath size. When you have 6 French sheaths, you do expect that up to 11%, and 5 French is just 2%. So the sheath size differs. This may happen from 7.7% to 5.5% if you measure radial artery occlusion immediately one day after the procedure, as opposed to post the procedure due to otofibrinolysis that may happen further after the few days. It may be 9% versus 4.5% when you do coronary artery diagnostic angio versus BCI. It happens more with the diagnostic one because usually we are giving an aggressive antithrombotic therapy with the BCI patients. So this reduces the incidence of radial artery occlusion. So now what are the predictors for radial artery occlusion? Smaller caliber, larger size sheaths, females, diabetics, and coronary kidney disease, okay? And definitely spasm that we have to alleviate. However, the predictors, major predictors of the radial artery occlusion are two: proper anticoagulation, presence or absence of patent hemostasis. Anticoagulation plays a crucial role to prevent radial artery occlusion. In one study, radial artery occlusion was 70%. Two-thirds of your patients will radial artery occlude if you didn't use heparin, even if your patient is in warfarin, even if your INR is 2. So heparin is a must to prevent. Even the dose of the heparin itself differs from. When you use just a small dose, 2,000, the incidence was approximately 24. And when you use appropriate dose, approximately 5,000, approximately 5 or 4% radial artery occlusion happens. So the heparin and its dose differs. As I mentioned right now, the sheath size, 5 versus 6 French. And I do expect that if you use 7 French, I think the radial artery occlusion will be higher. How to compress? Are you compressing by just usual dressing, or you are using band, TR band, dedicated TR band? TR band usually associated with 4.5% or 5%. And this may be 20% radial artery occlusion because you will completely occlude the artery. Compression time even differs when you use 2 versus 6 hours of compression. So usually the shorter, the better for those patients. Not only that, even you are applying the standard design to reduce radial artery occlusion, when you compress the ipsilateral ulnar artery, this gives more blood. Mechanical opening of the radial artery preventing thrombosis, I think also it helps to reduce. So how to prevent radial artery occlusion? We have to minimize the radial trauma from the beginning. So first attempt, I think it will be the best attempt to prevent damage of the endothelium. Heparin 5,000, I think the standard dose right now to give for your patients, even if your patient is in warfarin. Prophylactic ipsilateral ulnar artery, please try. And I am teaching my patients right now for ipsilateral ulnar artery compression 1 day, 2 days, 3 days. And even more, I started to ask them to keep the radial band to compress if required. So we have to give bolus dose of 500 microgram nitroglycerin before sheath removal. We finish the procedure, please give, based on the hemodynamics of your patient as well. But I am routinely giving at least 100 microgram nitroglycerin before I remove the sheath. I am reducing the duration of the hemostatic compression. And the most important is the patent hemostasis. Patent hemostasis is a must to reduce radial artery.
عن سكرو وعبارة عن باد. لو انتم شايفين كده تحت انا بلف.
We have many designs of the TR bands. many design, any design of them, I think will be sufficient. But how to just prepare your TR band, whatever it's design, and please, what we will do?
هذه البنكشر سايت بتاعنا موجود وده الـ PR band بتاعنا
السكرو
حط على البنكشر سايت كده بالظبط واضحه الصوره
بليز دي
تمام
يور باند اكزاكتلي ات ذا بنكشر سايت
او اربط الشيز بتاعنا
تايتن
هنا او هعمل تايتنينج
تايتن دي
بسم الله الرحمن الرحيم اشيل الشيز
تايتن
الشيز
اوكي
اشيل الشيز بتاعنا
كومبليتلي اكلود ذا راديال ارتري completely reduce the radial include the radial artery
ده التكنيك بتاع البيتنت هيموستاسيس اللي احنا هنعمله دلوقتي ادي دلوقتي مفيش اي بلد خرج
على ايدي
حاضر مفيش مشكله خلاص
اوكي ذا بيشنت سافرنج رايت ناو سو وات اي ويل دو اي ويل ديفليت اي ويل ديفليت اي ويل ديفليت
اوكي او سايد شيز
اي ويل ديفليت
بيتنت هيموستاسيس اي ويل ريدوس ذس تايتنينج
حركه ديفليت Until blood comes.
لحد ما نشوف في بلساتايل اوز.
Until بلساتايل
لحد دلوقتي bleeding comes. في البلساتايل اوز او يعني حاجه bleeding كده
خفيف. Did you see? I think it's clear right now.
شايفين البلد؟
اوكي.
خلاص؟ Two or three بلساتايل اوزز. ارجع واحد.
So I will retighten just one millimeter.
And that's it. خالص. ماشي اعتقد.
So this is the technique of patent hemostasis.
وانا اتشيف دلوقتي البيتنت هيموستاسيس.
So I just, I would like also just for this radial artery occlusion, just would like to share with you this patient, 39, a male patient with proved COVID-19 4 months before coming to us with acute coronary syndrome, non-ischemic elevation myocardial infarction. We did BCI to LAD, but 1 week later, the patient came with agonizing right arm pain. Agonizing. Patient was screaming from the pain. So we did CT scan. This CT scan proved evidence of totally occluded radial artery from its origin. Just if half millimeter from its origin. Radial artery occlusion. Okay, radial artery occlusion. So what I did, I went from the femoral approach, anti-gradely, crossed the occluded segment, ballooned, okay, opened the flow, and this is a balloon. The flow a little bit opened, and we started glycoprotein to B3 receptor antagonist until we restored the flow, the patient markedly improved. So how to treat radial artery occlusion? Treatment conservative 50% of them will recanalize spontaneously within 1 month. Pharmacological approach, we can give enoxaparin for 4 weeks in symptomatic patients will result in further recanalization. Approximately 90% of the cases will improve. We will restore flow approximately in 1 month by enoxaparin. Ulnar compression, as I mentioned you right now, so please teach your patient how to compress the ulnar artery. When you use a TR band, please, you can keep it with the patient. He or she can reuse if the radial artery is occluded. Percutaneous recanalization, as we showed right now, and sometimes surgical correction if your patient is still symptomatic. And the best approach to treat radial artery occlusion is to prevent, as I mentioned this patient before, this is a patient who presents with a anterior ischemic elevation myocardial infarction. I left for my junior and he did it because I was busy. And unfortunately, he did the puncture exactly at the styloid process. The artery is very, very small here. The patient came after 1 week crying from the forearm pain. CT scan proved evidence of completely occluded radial artery, but from almost the mid segment. But just look here. The radial artery was high thick of radial artery, abnormal anatomy. Those arteries usually are very, very, very irritable, very small, very spastic arteries and prone to close. So I think one of the mistakes of my junior was this approach from the very distal segment. And I think also the patient was unlucky because of this high thick of radial artery. So the best strategy to prevent radial artery occlusion is to prevent from the beginning. Vasovagal attack would happen. What is the percentage? Based on our study, in 1,000 patients, we experienced it in 18 patients. So the incidence very, very low, very low incidence. However, we have to tackle it as well. I would like to prevent such vasovagal attack. Presented by the patient usually presents with malaise, sweating, dizziness, nausea, vomiting. This is the mechanism by vagal stimulation, and the major predictors are mental stress. insufficient local anesthesia, painful stimulus, and hypovolemia. So please, don't ask your patient to fast for 12 hours or for 6 hours or whatever. Okay, I think 2 or 3 hours are more than enough. Even you can give the patient fluid, okay, just to prevent the dehydration. There are 2 types or 3 types, cardio inhibitory or vasodepressor or mixed type. Should you should prepare our patient. We should ask your patient to tell him, to teach your patient about the procedure to alleviate spasm. And we should prevent hypovolemia. Okay, and I think atropine, dopamine will work together with fluid. And in one patient, one of my patients experienced complete heart block necessitating insertion of temporary pacemaker. The last... أيوه. خلاص, I'm finishing.
لا لا, هقول لك بس معلش, أنا آسف. So sorry والله. عندي complete heart block و acute STEMI في الـ ER دلوقتي.
يلا حبيبي, توكل على الله. Please.
يلا, سلام عليكم.
Okay, I'm finishing. Okay, I'm finishing in 2 minutes. Okay, so TRA is rare. There are many rare complications like granuloma, aneurysm, arteriovenous fistula, radial artery avulsion, delayed hemorrhage, causalgia or pain, that prolonged pain, and pectoral bleeding. Fortunately, I didn't see any one of these except this granuloma. This is my patient, one of approximately 6,000 or 7,000 that I have seen this patient. What is a granuloma? It presents as a swelling, redness, and tenderness. It has been reported as a consequence of chronic inflammation. It is it is abscess, but not an abscess. It is a sterile abscess, what I mean. Typically appears 2 weeks after the procedure and usually can be confirmed by ultrasound to differentiate it from the pseudoaneurysm. Pseudoaneurysm also, it is very, very rare. I didn't see single one. But I think it can be treated also by our TR band. You can just compress and it will improve. Radial artery avulsion or eversion, I didn't see in my life, but it is reported in literature. To conclude about the complications, transradial artery or transradial axis complication associated with less complications compared to the transfemoral approach. I think this is a fact. Many of these complications are preventable. And the commonest TRA dedicated complications include spasm, hematoma, radial artery occlusion, perforation, and other rare complications. Please, early recognition and managing such a complication is crucial to maintain safety, efficacy, as well as patient satisfaction. And I would like all of you to shift for the radial approach. Thank you so much.
Shukran. شكرا دكتور منصور.
شكرا دكتور منصور.
Hello, it's a very nice lecture as usual.
Thank you so much,
دكتور منصور.
Thank you so much,
Your lecture is very nice حقيقي يعني. That from the start, from your lecture, I will feel the complication of from transradial more or less equal to transfemoral. But I think it is can preventable more than transfemoral. And it's very, very important. The message from this lecture, when we started to do well, transradial training before starting, especially in the early beginning, transradial approach. And the most of complication can be avoidable.
Yes.
My question is, Dr. Mansour, as regard if we, when the physician, when sees most or some problems like dilated aortic arch or severe looping in the aortic arch, that can making the rotation of the catheter or guiding, it's very difficult.
Yes.
If we change or shift to the left radial artery, can solve this problem or the same tips and or some points of difficulties can we see? That's the first question. Second question, it is any predictors for the expected complications from patient to another? It's very important.
Yes, okay. Regarding your first question, I do agree 100% about the less incidence of subclavian artery tortuosities in the left as opposed to the right one. And to be frank with you, I am going right now shifting completely to the left side, exactly through the distal left radial approach. But I do agree with you. Yes, the incidence of the tortuosities are less in the left side. Aggressive manipulation of the catheter usually may result in kink, or sometimes may result in complete knot that I think will make your life a little bit difficult to manage. So I do advise, I will post the magnificent presentation by my colleague, Dr. Hatim Al-Lawati, in the Al-Azhar Radial course Facebook page. But right now, please, don't rotate your catheter 300 degrees at all. Maximum, while you are rotating your catheter in cases of difficulties of tortuosities or loops or whatever, just make it approximately at 90 degrees and the wire is inside it until you cross to the ascending aorta. Aggressive maneuver of the catheter without wire inside will definitely will result in either catheter kink, and in severe situations will catheter knot. So exactly as you said, most of our complications are preventable rather than to treat. So prevention is much better than to treat. This is the first question. Yes, the patient's profile differ from one to another. I will give you difficult demographic criteria for our patients. I think when I treat 60 or make it 40, 50 years old male patient, totally different when you treat a patient 80 years old. With this 80 years old, you will find many of these patients many difficulties, like at least subclavian tortuosities that we are discussing right now. But believe me, those patients of eight octogenarian patients or elderly patients themselves, if you will cross to the femoral approach, it will not be paved as well. You will find a lot of problems as well. Iliac artery tortuosis, femoral artery tortuosis, aorta, and all these complications. Yeah. Okay, short stature as well, I think, represents another issue for us. Short stature, because usually those patients will have short descending aorta or what is called horizontal aorta, and engaging of the coronaries will be, I think, a little bit difficult. Other patients also, diabetics, hypertensive patients, coronary kidney disease, usually they have endothelial dysfunction and more prone for spasm and dissection, and all these complications may happen with these patient categories. Now, please, Dr. Mansour.
Thank you, Dr. Mansour. As the last question, please, when you started to do bifurcation PCI, as you know, sometimes we need the large sheaths, seven French, to maybe need the two balloons, two devices. What about your opinion? Which is better, transfemoral or transradial, especially in normal physician not having a good experience in transradial?
Okay, so I will start from the end. If you don't have good experience, so you don't start complex procedures from the beginning. I think there is a proposed proficiency level or competency level. When you start, you have to start by the diagnostic catheters, and you have to choose your patient from the beginning. How to choose your patient? Choose the male patients, not females, large body stature, okay, just to have good radial artery, okay, prepare your patient very nice. Start by diagnostic once. Then, after 50 patients, I think you can start with simple PCI patients. Okay, after acquiring experience, you can choose all comers patients for diagnostic one. The fourth step is to choose any PCI, whatever. The fifth one is to start the STEMI protocol. This, after approximately 400 patients, you can master your radial approach and you can start complex procedures like bilateral CTO, bifurcations, or whatever. I will come to your question right now. Okay, when we need seven French catheter right now, I think, as I mentioned clearly right now, when you use large sheaths in such situations, radial artery occlusion is higher incidence. Okay, so now there are many tools that refined, like what is called cylinder sheaths. Cylinder sheaths, if you have this sheath, five French, it accommodates six French guide catheter. If you have cylinder sheaths, six French, it accommodates seven French catheter. Okay, what is the difference between transradial and transfemoral? Believe me, Once you engage the coronaries, either from femoral or from radial, okay, with good support, finished. Both of them almost the same. So the main issue is to have large caliber or large bore sheath to accommodate large guiding catheter. Once you are in the coronaries, no problem at all. In such a situation, you can perform whatever you would like, bifurcation or CTO or complex issues. And I am doing comfortably most of bifurcations, also from the radial approach by 60 French, that can accommodate easily one balloon and one stent that we can use at the same time.
Yeah, thank you.
My pleasure. Any questions from the audience? No questions from the audience?
Okay, Dr. Musallam, sometime we do transradial and the course of procedure is smooth and no any problem. After that, as before finishing, there's some onco, you remove the sheath. We feel the patient the suffering from pain, suffering from numbness. And at the same time, your friend is sometimes coming for you to do BCI, especially physician need the fine skills in the procedure, like ophthalmologist, the catheter, التجميل, plastic surgery. We need fine touch. There is, I read one paper, one or two, there is some residual of numbness after transradial. Yes. What's your opinion from the start? You do the procedure through transfemoral or transradial?
Okay. Let us agree from the beginning. The safety profile of the transradial approach is higher than the transfemoral approach. Yeah. And believe me, I think you have seen definitely so many complications from the transfemoral approach. Retro peritoneal hematoma, at least massive hematoma, and so many complications. And this is the value of transradial approach that we have to keep. But the issue right now is how to minimize such complications. This is the issue right now that we have to discuss. Proper preparation of the patient is a must. You have to teach your patient. This is the procedure that requires high tech. You have to be calm because the radial artery is very, very small. And at the meantime, you have to give your patient to anxiolytic therapy, and you have to calm down your patient as much as you can to prevent radial artery spasm. You have to hydrate your patient properly. You have to have skills to get the radial artery from the first puncture. Like all these procedures or simple issues, I think, will minimize the pain, will minimize the spasm. However, if you are the best interventionist worldwide, such complications will happen because of the anatomic variations that will happen to the patient, like high thick of radial artery. Such high thick of radial arteries having high tendency for spasm, even if you are giving these patients large doses of anxiolytic therapy. Those spasms usually are very long, very diffuse, and usually they don't respond to extra vasodilatory cocktail. So what to do? I think this is against our will, and this is a pitfalls of the radial approach. Fortunately, as we mentioned in the beginning of our discussion, such varieties happen more in the right side. So for that time, I am shifting a little bit to the left side. So what we can do, I think we can minimize. We have to do our best first, and we have to know the pitfalls of the radial approach and how to overcome.
Okay. Thank you, Prof.
There are questions.
Hashem? Your question, yes. Hashem?
I think he didn't. You have to allow him.
I think Hashem is Zomer.
You can read his question.
Dr. Maksud.
Dr. Sham is asking about what is strategy to suggest for compression post-radial. So I said, Dr. Sham, there are many ways you can use the compression by the gauze or whatever, but I think TR band, whatever the design, it is not a problem at all. So as we mentioned, this should be done immediately. We have to give nitrates as we are giving, and you know that very well. We have to minimize to do the patent hemostasis for 2 hours. So I think this is the ideal for all patients. Second question, Dr. Masoor.
Dr. Hisham Zomer asked as regards the five French when doing through BCI through five French in some patients, and it can be capable for the performing completely procedure. I think it, he is asked already.
Okay, so I think five French, yes. I think, and I think it is better in terms of spasm. Why spasm? Because the friction with the artery, I think, will be less. If you have five French, so approximately 1.7 millimeter, and your the radial artery is approximately 2.6. So you will have some space or less friction as opposed to the six French, and definitely with seven French. So five French is preferred. And if your patient is going for five for diagnostic angiography, I do prefer to do all patients with five French. In other countries, there is even four French diagnostic catheter and sheaths as well that I didn't see and I didn't work with. But at least, I think at least we have to have the five French sheath, five French diagnostic catheters for patients who assigned for just diagnostic catheters only.
Yes. What is the place of transradial approach in the form of retrograde BCI in CTO, Dr. Mansoor Salam?
I think we will demonstrate. Okay, we demonstrate. We did many patients bilateral radial approach for the patients. Bilateral radial approach for CTO. So it is not a problem. Just we while you are in the coronaries, so nothing at all. Okay, just proper support. Everything is done. No difference from the transfemoral approach. You can do antegrade, you can do retrograde or whatever. But this do I do prefer for patients with large radial arteries, large body mass index patients that can accommodate six or seven French guiding catheter for long time. So I think this approach should be reserved for those patients.
One question from Dr. Abdulrahman Mitwalli. Okay, in case of radial artery perforation, could we use double technique like a cast tamponade, like a cast tamponade from the inside and the cuff from outside initiated okay. of cover the stent? Okay.
Okay. I think there is very the innovative idea as well. It's very nice. I didn't try. It could be, okay, but I didn't try. No problem. I think even in the literature, no one tried it. We'll try Dr. Abrahman, inshallah, next time. It's not a problem at all. But I would like to have no perforations at all. I would like to prevent perforation rather than to treat a perforation. But I do assure you, nobody tried it. We can try next time when you hear for it.
Okay. There is any questions? Any other questions? Okay, Dr. Salah. Thank you very much, Dr. Mansoor.
My pleasure, Dr. Mansoor. I was pleased to see you, pleased to see all attendees, pleased to see Dr. Ahmed Nada. I don't know why he's mute right now. Dr. Hisham, I think there is another question about the CABG. What is your daily practice in both the CABG vascular axis? How to get the lima from the right? Okay, so Dr. Hisham is asking, I think, a nice question. About my practice from the beginning to get the CABG patient is to get from the left radial approach. It was conventional, but right now we are doing from the distal left radial, which is more convenient to the operator and more convenient to the patient as well.
Yes,
and he's asking another question, how to get the lima from the right radial. Okay. I think what is the necessity to get the lima from the right radial approach? I think nothing. Unless there is a problem from the left radial approach, like patient with arteriovenous fistula for the hemodialysis, or just you are in the right side and anyone, you know, whatever, I don't know. I think it will be very, very situation. But how to get the radial, I think it is a cumbersome procedure, requires some dedicated catheters like Simon catheters. Sometimes you can get it from the by Tiger catheter. First of all, we have to go to the descending aorta first, go to the descending aorta, then counterclockwise the catheter while the wire just outside your the outside the catheter, your wire 0.35 wire, and counterclockwise will drop your catheter into the right subclavian artery, advance your wire to the brachial artery, and you can advance over the wire the catheter. If you can reach with the wire in the brachial artery, while you are having difficulty to advance your catheter, you can use a sphygmomanometer cuff to fix the wire in the brachial artery. Then the advancement of the diagnostic catheter will be a little bit easier, and try to negotiate to get the galena catheter in. But I do expect this is a cumbersome procedure, not easy procedure, but it's doing. And many of the operators worldwide doing it.
Well, I think Dr. Mansour, when we try to inject the lima, I think the form the left radial is better and easy.
Much better, yeah. But he's asking better. How to get from,
Much better. Repairable technique.
Yeah. Much better and more direct, yeah. I think, visualization. But he's asking how to get it from the right side, which is a little bit
Dr. Hisham, usually you need more difficulties.
Yeah. And he's doing, again, by the way, a very nice job as well with us
in
Islamic Center. Yeah. If no more questions, I think from the audience, we still have many audience with us. They are still. So I would like to hear any questions from them.
Dr. Salam, as regard the radial approach and the procedure, with well experienced, can decrease the complication or can prefer in patient like chronic kidney disease CKD.
Yeah.
Can you see before from your experience in much better than transfemoral in CKD as regarding if the procedure is smooth and you take can help you to take amount or less amount of contrast in this patient.
Okay. Let us say that, okay, we have three routes right now. We have femoral, we have right radial, we have left radial. For less experienced operators from transradial, usually they consume more contrast, they consume more radiation. But after acquiring experience, there is no difference between both of them. From the beginning, usually there is no difference between left radial and left femoral, even for non-experienced operators as well. So there is no difference. But the difference of the acute kidney injury comes from the concept that while you are working from the transfemoral approach, you may dislodge cholesterol emboli, okay, to the one of or both renal arteries while your wire or catheter hits the aorta at the ostia of the renal arteries. Cholesterol embolization may happen, and they may result in acute kidney injury, not related directly to the amount of contrast or contrast-induced nephropathy. Contrast-induced nephropathy is another issue that may happen even with a small amount of contrast, either from right, left, radial, or transfemoral approach. So this is another mechanism by which acute kidney injury happens rather than the contrast-induced nephropathy.
Okay, Dr. Mansour Salam, also, as we know, there is some history as regards the physician doing more and more radial procedures can expose to some complication, especially an eye complication, retinal detachment. What's your opinion for this problem? And is there isn't a protective issue when you do radial approach as regarding the machine or can decrease or know the amount of radiation exposed and compared to transfemoral?
Okay, so I think it's a very, very nice issue that we have to discuss in details, and we have, as operators, we have to protect ourselves from the radiation and how to minimize the amount of radiation. This is a very, very important issue online. Okay, the reducing the amount of contrast and the reducing the amount of radiation is very, very important. How? I think we can reduce the magnification to 7.5 frame time. I think it's very, very nice. We can see very, very well rather than as compared to 15. Most of our colleagues, especially juniors, they are pressing the paddle and they are putting their leg and I think it's tugged with the bagel, which shouldn't be at all. While we are changing from one view to another, I think we have to take our legs outside. So minimization, recognition of the amount of radiation should be recorded for each patient, and we have to reach the international standard. We have to have an audit personally and for each center, how much radiation you are utilizing for the diagnostic. We have to have the protection shields. We have to have the radiation tags to measure the amount of the radiation. So this is very, very basic issues that we have to follow for each patient.
Okay, Dr. Mansour, there is another question from Dr. Muhammad Ramadan. You see this question? I am not seeing from here.
No, I didn't see as well.
Yeah.
What is the question of Dr. Muhammad Ramadan? Where I could see Dr. Sham asking about, we have a patient with Lima LED, left radial graft to OM SVG RCA. We had to go to the femoral approach because we don't have Simon catheter, which bleeds, which bid special technique to navigate. Okay. Also some post cabbage patients, we have radial artery occlusion from invasive artery. So I think the transfemoral approach, we are not against. I think we have to teach, we have to learn, we have to be competent as well in the transfemoral approach. It is our friend. It is not a competitor to the radial approach as well. We are looking for the safety, better safety profile for all our patients. Where is Dr. Muhammad Ramadan question?
Yes. Is there any advantage for using sheathless? I don't see.
Yeah. This is Dr. Ramadan. Even I couldn't see, but anyhow. Okay, so our attempt right now is to reduce our goal, ultimate goal. Our goal is to reduce the radial artery occlusion, radial artery spasm, and to utilize large size catheters for complex lesions as well. One of these tools is a sheathless catheter. Sheathless catheter is 6.5 to 7 millimeter in diameter, which can accommodate two stents together. We can do complex lesions. So yes, this is advantage. But the most important disadvantage of this catheter, most important disadvantage is the support. It doesn't give you full support because there is movement is very, very, very easy either from the skin and from the ascending aorta point of view.
Yeah.
Dr. Muhammad Azim. Okay. So he didn't ask, he's just thanking and is shaking his hand. Dr. Fatma Al-Hadi, is there is any special technique when remove the sheath in the severe radial artery spasm? I think we discussed this in the last session, two weeks ago in details. There are many techniques to remove the entrapped sheath. It's entrapped. We cannot remove the sheath from the because of the intense spasm. One of the most important, Dr. Fatma, is to prevent. We have to prevent spasm from the beginning. We have to teach our patient. We have to relax our patient, calm him properly, prevent dehydration. But sometimes it happens. It happens, so I think I demonstrated that hot vomits will help to take the sheath out. If not helpful, you can use the sphygmomanometer cuff and fillet the cuff on the radial artery for approximately 5 minutes, 20 millimeter mercury above the systolic blood pressure. And usually due to accumulation of the metabolites, active metabolites, vasodilator metabolites, sheath will be removed. Some operators experienced that sheath also didn't come back. So usually they use deep sedation. If doesn't happen, usually they use light anesthesia. If didn't happen, they can do what is called nerve block. To the stages, if didn't improve or didn't solve the problem, the last issue is to ask the help of our vascular surgeons to open and to take the sheath out. So these are step by step. Fortunately, I didn't ask help until now, alhamdulillah, for the vascular surgeon to open on the entrapped sheath.
Yeah.
no more questions. There is Dr. Hisham Zomer again.
Dr. Mansour, just a comment, please.
Yeah, please.
Okay, regarding to avoid spasm during sheath retrieval or catheter retrieval, as you mentioned, exactly the best thing is the prophylaxis. Actually, what we are doing in our practice, we are introducing the straight wire, the other end of the wire, exactly near the tip, just trying to straighten the tip. This will minimize the friction during the catheter retrieval. This is one of the most important thing. The other thing, playing on the psychology. I mean, distracting the patient. Always, I'm talking to the patient before removing the catheter, trying to open any subject, talking to him, distracting his mind completely from what we are doing. And actually, this is one of the successful way we are following, just distract the mind of the patient and minimize the rate of spasm.
Exactly. Yeah, very nice. But some patients resist until the general anesthesia. Even after general anesthesia, some patients didn't respond. So I think I do agree 100% with you, especially for the prevention of spasm. But some spasms have been out of our will as well.
Okay.
So I think if there is no more questions.
Okay.
No more questions. Another...
I think, you know.
Okay. So if you'd like to end the session, Dr. Ahmed would like to comment. Ahmed Nada.
It's okay. I think there is one more question before closing.
Mm. What is the question? From whom?
I read it. From our colleague, Dr. Hisham Zomer. I think he's asking about the cocktail strategy, heparin and nitrates, or to add verapamil routinely. Just to give us a small comment regarding this one, and as I talked to you, Dr. Mansour, regarding I'm following the Japanese school of doing radial, and they are not giving cocktail at all. They are only giving heparin, and they are giving the dose of 5 for diagnostic and 10 for PCI, and less number they have. And actually, after following this practice, we have regarding radial spasm.
Okay. Could you please tell me, Dr. Ahmed, what is the percentage of the radial incidence of radial artery spasm at your center?
We don't have a clear statistics regarding this one, but I can guarantee it's less than 1%. The issue that always we are trying to minimize the manipulation, we are following the approach of anterior wall puncture. Despite all the fellowship programs following the poly technique, which penetrating the anterior and the posterior walls, after learning curve, we succeed to puncture the artery from the first time. For sure, we have dedicated radial kits, which actually help many, many, many times to avoid the radial spasm. Again, after learning curve, always we are not pushing against any resistance, trying to clarify actually our way. As you mentioned, we have already Tiger catheter. We have another brand which called the Ultimate catheter. So we can cannulate the right and the left by the same catheter. Sometimes we are using the 5 French catheter in diagnostic, and after assessment of the lesion, if there is a lesion, we can decide either to proceed with the same size for PCI or to change to 6 French. So most of the time we are taking a deep and detailed look regarding our equipment and how to avoid spasm.
Amazing issue. I think we discussed this issue 2 weeks ago, but I would like just to add for my colleagues, I did a deep research about the spasm And I found that approximately 14% of the center or operators, they didn't do exactly as the Dr. Ahmed Nada does. They didn't give any routine. But vast majority of operators, they give routinely cocktail of 100 or 200 GTN together with 2.5 verapamil. This is a routine almost always worldwide. Some centers, they are giving nicorandil rather than tridil or nitroglycerin or verapamil. Other giving diltiazem or whatever. But vast majority of operators, they are giving routine verapamil, 2.5, not 5, and 100 or 200 milligram nitroglycerin based on the hemodynamics of the patients. Okay. So, Dr. Mansour, I think we are exceeded already the time. Okay. If we'd like to conclude, Dr. Ahmed first and Dr. Mansour to finish the session. Would like to comment anything?
Yeah. Dr. Mansour is very thanks. Much thanks for you for this nice lecture. As regard transradial, already I am one of physician increasing my from your lecture. Increase my knowledge from this lecture, and also in the my private or even all procedure, I try to make the transradial superior than transfemoral. It is much easier. Mostly, with more experience, increasing much safer, and also the psychological for the patient is very important. The patient if diagnostic only. Or BCI after some hours, later some hours can discharge from the hospital. But it's very important before the start, I will try to prevent the complication and avoid any techniques or tip or some devote in the procedure to make the procedure as difficult or complex. And if the some sort of complication occurred, it's better to, it must be the physician know how to treat or overcome this problem. And many thanks, Dr. Mansour.
Thank you so much, my dear senior, Dr. Mansour. I learned a lot from you. Yani, you are my senior and I do respect that. Dr. Ahmed?
As Dr. Mansour mentioned, actually, I think all the attendees all over the course, I think they got the maximal benefit and the maximal gain regarding how to start their radial career. And even those who are expert in doing radial, I think they got a lot of experience. Despite we have done already thousands of cases, thousands of radial cases, I got learned a lot from this course. And as we discussed before, despite that those who did already thousands of cases, they don't have the deep insights regarding the literature and the anatomy and all the techniques. And I think this is the new idea of this course, that giving the details for those who are working without detailed scientific backgrounds. The most important thing, as you mentioned, Dr. Mansour, Mustafa and Dr. Mansour, the learning curve. And wherever the operator feels that actually he can master the radial, he will do it relaxedly without any stresses from outside. And he can take the proper decision either to proceed for radial despite any challenges during the procedure, or to change either to another axis, ANNR or ISO, the other radial or whatever, or to come to the femoral. So I think it's individual learning curve and individual experience to decide which approach will be fit for this procedure regarding his level of experience. Again, thanks a lot for this prestigious course.
Thank you so much, Dr. Ahmed, my colleague, Dr. Mansour, Dr. Abdel Masoud. I would like to express my deep happiness and pleasure and joy as well for this excellent panelist discussion. I would like to announce that inshallah next week will be the last week in the Al-Azhar Remedial course. In this course, we will discuss, Dr. Sameh supposed to discuss inshallah the tips and tricks in the transfemoral approach. I will discuss the tips and tricks in the distal left radial ulnar as well as radial approach. And we will end this Al-Azhar Remedial course inshallah, Nishna Kul Amr. And inshallah, we will have a new innovative idea inshallah to satisfy you. As far as there are no more questions, so I think we can end this session. We exceeded already approximately 10 or 15 minutes for the our time. And I would like to thank you again and see you inshallah next week. Yeah, assalamu alaikum. Assalamu alaikum.
Assalamu alaikum. Assalamu alaikum.